Okay, okay. 대강, 하?
네,
제 책을 좀 돌려드리러 하고, 하.
This check will revert to you later.
다음 시장을 가이죠, 하.
Mr. Tong, let's continue. Let's continue with our questions. Mr. Raymond Wong, thank you, Chairman. Mr. Timothy Tong is now testifying. This is the third time. Members have raised many questions. Last time, I did so in two sessions. I'm grateful to the chairman for giving me more time last time. Altogether, for the two sessions, I spent some 15 minutes on my questions. I'm most unhappy with your answers. So for some of the questions, I need to ask follow-up questions and I need to do a sum up. First, let me continue. Last time you didn't answer this question, and that is during your five-year tenure, in relation to the accession of China to the UN Convention Against Corruption, and in relation to your contact with the public security, procuratorates, and the judiciary, and of course those are official duties. We mentioned to the ICC ordinance, and you answered that it was a 12-year. But 12-year doesn't apply when you in relation to your contact with public funds, with entertainment, with those authorities outside the public security, procuratorate, and judiciary on the mainland. According to the, please tell us, under what section of the ICC ordinance have you been given this power? You answered that it was 12E, and that is in response to anyone to advise the person and to render assistance to the person on how to prevent corruption. My understanding is that this is about Hong Kong, and you are saying that this applies in relation to your contacts or communications with the mainland. You said it's 12-year. So, did you provide assistance in response to the in accordance with your own initiative, or did you do it in response to requests from them? Can you give us some examples? I would like to mention about cooperation with Guangdong, and also the cooperation with departments and ministries, apart from the three mentioned. There were a cooperation project to produce an anti-corruption or corruption prevention video. Let's see how this is appropriate. There were visits, there were tours, according to the information we have been given. And there were also the exchange programs involving Hong Kong students and students from the mainland. Did you see the department people from the Department of United Front? I think you are talking about the publicity, the propaganda department, the department responsible for United Front. I don't really know the exact title. My question is very clear. Did you see people from the United Front Department? Yes, it was related to our work. Mr. Tong, please provide clear answers. You are a member of the CCPCC. Did you see someone from the United Front Department? Yes. Okay, that's good enough. Yes, it's a good enough answer. can he be allowed to give one more example? And the department responsible for telecommunications and broadcasting was also the one of them. That has to do with film and television. I asked whether he's met someone from the United France Front Department. You don't have to talk about the other bureau for the telecommunications and broadcasting. All right, please continue. So you met people from the United Front Department. That department is also responsible for the recruitment or appointment of members of CCPCC. Are you aware of this? Please, go back a bit. Well, please tell us how this is relevant to the value for money. Well, this is, of course, related. From the 31st day, in Mr. Tong said when he came on the first occasion to tell us to testify, he said China is a signatory to UNCAC, so that was related to his work. And last time he talked about 12E, but 12E is not supposed to be relied on for offering entertainment to mainland officials. And now I'm talking about those non-public security, non-procuratorate and non-judiciary, the departments and people. You said meet the United Front Department, and I asked whether you are aware that this particular United Front Department is responsible for making appointments to the CPCC. And if your answer is in the affirmative, I will ask whether your CPPCC membership was the result of the United Front Department's appointment. And did you offer entertainment if you had dinners with them? Well, please be fair. Let's put one question at a time. I do not know the duties of United Front Department. Many people from the liaison office or the United Front Department visited the ICC. We did not offer entertainment or treat them to the dinner. When was you appointed as a member of the CPPCC, Mr. Wong? Again, what's the relevance of this to the report, audit report? Well, you didn't allow me to ask this question. Let me explain. As a head, as the head of a law enforcement agency, you were head of ICAC for 5 years. You were responsible for the ridding Hong Kong of corruption, and you were supposed to uphold a clean politics in Hong Kong. CPPCC, to many people in Hong Kong or to ordinary citizens on the mainland, is an organization that would attract a negative image or the comments. I'm not talking about things that I don't have evidence. For example, many people say that CPPCC membership could be bought. Please don't interrupt me. Don't break in all the time. How sensitive is this? This is not really whether it's sensitive. This is not about whether it's sensitive. I'm not trying to stop you. I'm trying to ask you to tell us the relevance. Please explain why this is relevant. Since you're talking about CPPCC, I'm coming to that. please bear with me. Maybe I should change my question. In your testimony, and also from the information provided by the ICC, we have discovered something, and that is as the commissioner of ICC during your five-year term, you purchased quite substantial quantities of wine and hard liquor. The quantities were much higher than your predecessors. And for hard liquor, it's mainly Mao Tai. And even for the Center of Anti-Corruption Studies, many bottles of Mao Tai were consumed. So we were curious why your entertainment would have to involve hard liquor. And you, in the maid, you'd consumed hard liquor to entertain mainlanders. And now you are now a member of the CPPCC. Therefore, we had certain doubts whether during your term you did discuss with someone that you would like to become a member of the CPPCC. Can you please give us his answer? No, not at all. And also, after your term as commissioner expired, why did you accept the appointment to CPPCC? Well, that goes beyond the audit report. I have to say that this is not related to the report. Mr. Tong, if you like to, you can give an answer. Well, I will answer this. I think that in terms of the development of our system, we are an advanced territory. I accepted the appointment to the CPPCC because I think in terms of the development of system, I will be able to do something that would benefit the mainland. And there's a close relationship between Hong Kong and mainland, and our SMEs are very much involved in the mainland. And if there's a better cooperation in the financial sector, it's not just about economic benefits. Hong Kong would be benefited if they can have a better and more developed system. All right. Yeah. Any follow-up? Well, he has given us an answer, but that's not really a relevant answer. You were the head of ICAC. They might want to leverage on your experience, but you don't know what the members of CPPCC are doing. Well, the CPPCC is advisory in nature. It's just a talking shop, a window dressing instrument in the political system. What's your follow-up question? Don't think you are very smart and talk about financial matters and economic matters. So you're saying that I was head of ICAC for 5 years and I'm very experienced, I will be able to make a contribution. Well, please don't talk to the camera.
No. Well, my question is very simple. Actually, I've already finished my question and I think everybody knows what I'm asking. I don't think you know anything about being a member of the CPPCC, and then yet still you accept the appointment. So I will leave it to the public to make the judgment. I also have another important question. During your term as the commissioner, there is a vote to store the alcoholic, beverages at the ICAC. The chairman ask you why the ICE would need to accept gifts, even if you did not pocket those gifts. Why did the ICC have to receive gifts? We are public organizations who were not allowed to receive gifts, otherwise they'll be invited to enjoy coffee at the ICC office and then, sent to prison. why do you need to give $58,000 of cookies as gifts? You've not answered the question. How was that related to your work? All right, I will leave that aside. Now, I'll now come to my next question. It's the ICAC. During your five-year term, why were there so much, you know, official entertainment? What was the purpose, Mr. Tong? During my 5 years term of office, the increase in official entertainment and exchanges with external parties actually took place at the same time. Regarding the increase in official entertainments, and according to the figures that I have available, actually there was such an indication when I first took up my office in 06-07. And there were already more items of official entertainment. Well, because of the PAC, the Audit Commission report, the existing commissioner also has given some response, and he issued a new guideline on the 5th of May, all because of you. According to this new guideline, I think we also criticized the new guidelines. We also criticized him because a subordinate was allowed to approve expenditures to be incurred by his superior. Okay, we don't care about the media, but we believe in the Audit Commission's report. I think it's because everything was a mess during your 5 years term. As a result, the current commissioner has to issue new guidelines. And after issuing the new guidelines, they turn out be so ridiculous. We already have the civil service regulations. So, Chairman, he was the commissioner for 5 years. For all these expenditures on public official entertainment, did he strictly follow the rules governing civil servants? I believe that our operations were all in compliance with the civil service regulations, but you were not civil servants. However, in terms of, well, within the procedure and regulations, I think it's been shown that we follow the spirit of the civil service regulations, although the wordings of our regulations are not 100% identical to that of CSR, but we basically follow the same spirit. Mr. Raymond Wong, that's section 751 of the CSR, that is for the commissioner, deputy commissioner, in approving expenditures on official entertainment. So the responsibility rests with you. Today, however, the new commissioner has issued a new guideline which actually targets all the loopholes which were found during your term. It's obvious. The Audit Commission has published a report when it published report number 60, the current commissioner responded to what was in that report. So there was a mess during your term, and your successor is now trying to clear up that mess and issue the new guidelines. Have you read those new guidelines? Well, the new guidelines were promulgated by Mr. Pei. I have, some understanding of those new guidelines, but I've not read them in detail. So could you answer Mr. Wong's question? I don't agree that during my term, everything was a mess. For example, and all the accounts were a mess. Regarding the procurement of alcoholic beverages and charging the cost for the meals and the drinks to separate heads or votes, my understanding that the Audit Commission has highlighted this point, but I don't know whether or not the same practice was found in the past. If this is the first time that this gray area has been identified and it was not a breach and it was not proven or pointed out that this had not been done before, perhaps the same practice had been done previously, except that it had not been identified. the suggestion that for improvement is a good thing, but it doesn't mean that everything was in a mess before. I think we're not talking about what happened before your commission. Well, your term, the audit commission's report is about what happened during your term. And Simon Pei has to come up with the new guidelines in response to the audit commission's report and all the deviations from the CSR which took place during your term. Just the... You say you don't know whether or not there have been separate, the cost of meals and drinks were charged separately. Well, what I'm asking at you is whether you agree that the new guidelines published on May 6 was promulgated because they need to make an adjustment in the light of what happened during your term. Well, I think he already said that he does not agree. Would you like to also add? I don't agree that the accounts were a mess. But I agree that if you discover any grey areas in the system, they should be improved. Chairman, according to the civil service regulations, I refer to the so-called wine cellar. During your term, did you procure certain alcoholic beverages beforehand and then you only charge it to the account when they have to be used or even split the bills? Well, according to my understanding, some departments had procured those alcoholic beverages beforehand, and that was the CRD and the administration headquarters. When I checked the records, there were two lists in the document. As to whether or not the quantity was substantial or not, I remember that the admin department procured hard liquor and did not amount to one bottle per month over the 5-year period. So you did not buy more than 1,000 bottles. For red wine, there weren't more than 1,000 bottles. I think this morning Mr. Leung and Mr. Chen also asked the same question. Don't say it's only one or two bottles. We're talking about more than 1,000 bottles of wine. Mr. Raymond Wong, please go on. Now, first of all, we have to make a comparison. Well, this was not done by previous commissioners. Perhaps there were some alcoholic beverages, but not as many as it was the case during your term. And also, no hard liquor was procured or used before you became the office. According to my record, there was 1 year, in which a hard liquor was used. No, I don't agree. If you check the records, I think by hard liquor, basically we mean Mao Tai and brandy. Those are called hard liquor. The wine, the table wine that we're talking about would be red wine made of grapes. I think that table is very clear. I think we read that table, okay. Please go on with the question. Mr. Tong, are you able to answer the question? I'm looking at Appendix 15 of Gen 3. The relevant year is 0405. Please go on. And it's shown here that for that yeah, 12 bottles of wine were procured, hard liquor, 12 bottles, quantity consumed, 12, wine was 12, hard liquor, 11. That's 2004. Can members find that document? It's on page 95 of the Chinese version. So are you saying that Mr. Raymond Wong is wrong? I dare not say the member is wrong. Well, you can soon say that if he is wrong. It's fine. It's fine. Chairman, when I look at the certificates, Chairman, I think it's in our document for the year 2004-2005, you bought 12 bottles of wine 11 bottles of hard liquor, all consumed, no inventory. That's the only year. So I have to amend my question. Why is it that before your term, all the previous commissioners, they only bought 11 bottles of hard liquor while you were the commissioner, the number increased so many times? That is a fact, right? Okay, let's not play with the words. Let's stick to the facts. So why? Mr. Tong, could you explain why? Well, this is because both international, there were more international regional exchanges as well as exchanges with the mainland. And also, in view of the counterparties involved in those exchanges, and also the culture of such exchanges at the time, and this morning we asked you whether or not the ICAC started to build up this culture of drinking alcohol. Mr. Wong, well, it's not the first time that he give this answer. Since we were able to compare the figures or the quantities, he would have explained. Well, he said that because of there were such exchanges. Well, I think the official entertainment of the ICAC should not involve the consumption of hard liquor. That's my personal opinion. And I think they shouldn't even consume any alcoholic beverages at all. For the ICAC to promote the message of fight against corruption, why was it necessary to drink alcoholic beverages? We have high expectations of the police, so that the ICAC, same for the police. Unless it's a private party, it's a different story. For any official, functions, there's no need to consume liquor. Well, my guess is that you are also very fond of drinking. Do you like to drink Mao Tai? He can choose not to answer my question. I think it is my opinion that you like to drink hard liquor. Okay, I'll answer the question. I personally has the habit of drinking, but it doesn't mean that I like to consume such a liquor on official functions. Personal preferences, I have my own preferences on private occasions, but I have other considerations when I'm, at work or Mr. Allen Leung? Thank you. Chairman, I really would like to clarify the facts to be fair to the witness. Now, during Mr. Tong's 5-year term of office as the commissioner, in respect of what the CRD should do and what were the expenses that should be charged to the account of CRD and whether or not it should be charged to the admin department or the prevention of corruption department. Could you explain to us the decision-making process in this regard in the ICAC at the time? Mr. Tong, I think we've asked many questions of the same nature. Please answer the question. If you don't, you can answer that question on other occasions, but if you could answer our question today, it would be good for everybody, and it will certainly help us when we drive our report. For the larger functions, it would be the heads of the department, at least to the rank of assistant director, who would discuss this, and there would be an occasion for them to discuss this with, together with the commissioner, regarding the organization activities. There would be documents and records stating the purpose of the activity, the resource requirements, the expected outcome, and then there would be an occasion when either the relevant departments and the commissioner will make an appointment to discuss that. And if a event of a large scale were involved, there would be a commissioner's weekly meeting where this would be brought up. And when that was discussed, certainly we would discuss the question of cost and also the purpose of the event, who would be organizing that. And whichever the department is responsible for organizing the event, then the expenses would be charged to the account of that department. Ellen, are you happy with that answer? Not quite enough, but I understand that it would be futile for me to pursue this further. But anyway, let me put the question in a different way. During your five-year term, had there been any expenses or which department, decisions regarding which department should do what? Had there been any such decisions for which you were not involved in the decision-making process? That is, when these activities were all being organized, when there's a question of how the expenses were to be charged, should it be charged to the account of the CRD or the admin department or the prevention of corruption department? Well, we asked you already this morning whether or not, for example, cookies should be treated as gifts or souvenirs, and also the question of how many cookies should be procured and to whom they should be given. Had there been any such decisions where you were not involved in the decision-making process? Yes. The Commissioner of the ICA said have a lot of work to do, and regarding the operations of various departments, the Commissioner may not be involved each and every time. Could you tell us which were the occasions in which you were not involved? If I were not involved, I wouldn't even know, because the heads of under the ICAC, each department has its own operation. It's led by a department with his or her respective authorities. I think if the staff of a certain department need to go on an overseas visit, he would require my approval. But the detailed arrangements regarding such an official visit, what souvenirs should be presented, and so on, I would not know. Ellen.
During the hearing, when we were gathering the evidence, mention has been made about different items of expenditure. Do you recall any of them that you didn't take part at all, but you learned about that from others, and they were decided upon by others in your department? Yes, for the CRD, there was a series of activities, including entertainment. Did not have my participation at all, but of course for very large scale activities like officiating at some of them, I did take part. So it's really mainly carried out by the department or departments themselves. And for the CACS, they spend about $6 million a year. It was known to you, right? Yes, you knew it. Now this morning, I also asked a question earlier on, page 34 of Gen 10. Well, I would like to know whether the resources came from the administration branch or the corruption prevention department. It was known to you, right? Page 34, Chinese version of Gen 10. Chinese version, Gen 34, $930,000, read out by Mr. Leung. So please assist him in finding the page. $950,000, more than that. So transferred from the admin to the CRD, January 2011. You knew about that? Yes, of course I knew it, and to a very large extent it was my decision. And you were aware of the acquisition of each and every bottle of hard liquor. I can't really say. Well, in an earlier session, you said that for each bottle of hard liquor, it required your approval. Yes, I recall what I said was as follows. If it required my approval, I agree. As to the details of each acquisition, I don't think I can recall. So you just close your eyes and you put down your signature. No. Perhaps sometimes they could do it on their own without requiring mine. But you didn't give this answer last time. If my approval had been required, then I would agree. I would have agreed. That's how I answered this question. Were you aware of the recruitment of Professor Yun? Recruitment of Mr. Yun? Yes, it was known to me. That's it. Just now, I said that Professor Yun could not have, in relation to enlisting the public support against corruption, have contributed, and yet you employed him for 1 year. So regarding such matters, you wouldn't say that you had no role at all. You are not changing your evidence, right? What is your evidence, Mr. Tong? Mr. Chairman, I hope I have your permission. On this matter, members have asked many questions concerning this part. Let me answer the question and then I'll try to add to my answer. Yes, you are entitled to do so. Please answer the questions clearly. Please don't give different answers on different occasions. It's fine if you supplement your answers, but everything has been recorded. For Professor Yun, for his appointment, it was known to me. I also agreed. And I also believed that his appointment was appropriate. He met the requirements. I just want to add as to why I thought that as far as value for money is concerned, Professor Yun's work was value for money. Also allow me to say that his post wasn't under the CRD. So if we look at the functions of the commissioner, then it is not items F and G that apply here. We want to have a more in-depth understanding of anti-corruption work. And this means that the department and staff members can work better. By that, we can enlist public support. I have to point out that please do not think that just because we are the operational staff and then we understand what is around us. Well, Professor Yun didn't come to tell us how good the mainland system was, but he told us about the features of the mainland system. It is useful for cooperation. Now, let me cite a number of examples. Now, anti-corruption work rests with the ICAC. We have a lot of powers. We are only accountable to the CE, and then we have very efficient work. In the mainland, they have a dual-track system. On the one hand, it means that the Supreme People's Procuratorate as well as the Provincial Procuratorate departments would do their work. They have also got the Ministry of Supervision, and they have also got the Central Discipline Committee of the party. So we want to know about the parameters of their powers and their functions. Sorry for having spent so much time on this. Now, for us to know about the work of the mainland at the regional level, at the international level, it would be of great use. On one occasion, I met with someone from the FBI. He approached me and he asked me about the Hong Kong system. And then he asked me about the comments on ASEAN and on the mainland. I was able to give him a detailed analysis. Part of the information came from Professor Yun. There is some information that I don't want to repeat too much. For SMEs, we tried very hard to cooperate with the SMEs. That's because SMEs, well, in fact, together with the Guangdong Provincial Procuratorate, we sort of alerted them of the SMEs' concerns. Alan, please continue. Well, the more I listened to Mr. Tong, the more I don't understand. Now, Chapter 7 is entitled Enlisting Public Support Against Cooperation. Now, you talked about helping the FBI getting information about the mainland. So I just wonder whether it is a case of misuse of public resources, public money. Later on, we'll come to our own judgment. Mr. Tong, last time you came as a witness, you talked about visits to the mainland. Every time you had the approval of the CE before you could go. So I want to know whether the then CE, namely Donald Zhang, also agreed with your approach that is use the money given to ICAC in that manner. Did you get his approval? Mr. Tong, the CE, the then CE, Mr. Zhang, himself did not look into the details of the departmental operation. In relation to the control, other than working through the commissioner of the ICAC, I can mention two other mechanisms. When we asked for funding, the administration branch, as well as the approval of the committees, had to be obtained before we go to other departments. So it wasn't the CE himself getting the figures. Well, in fact, we worked through the committees. And then on some larger projects, I can cite examples. No need. I think, Mr. Chairman, there isn't a need. To be fair to Mr. Tong, I want to ask the following question. Say, for example, your boss, your then boss, Mr. Donald Zhang, if he agreed with Mr. Tong that money allocated to the ICAC could be spent in this way, then you don't have to shoulder the liability on his behalf. Now, we are looking at value for money. We want to find out whether the work you have done is not proportional to the money spent by you. Now, if you say that you were then accountable to Donald Zhang directly, and if he agreed with your approach, then we might not be as harsh as we are now towards you. So I just want to give Mr. Tong a chance to explain himself. Now, Donald Zhang, the then CE, did not have the chance to look at the final details of the budget. But then at the regional level, at the international level, for us to expand our functions, there were more than one occasion for me to report to him. As to the details of these expenditures, he would not have known. And regarding my approach, I think I can describe it in this way. Sometimes he did not hold different comments. Sometimes, he did not object. And sometimes he said that he felt that it was useful to a certain extent in enhancing Hong Kong's reputation. Alan, I've given the opportunity to Mr. Tong if he chooses to be vague in his answers. If at the end of the day, if he incriminates himself, then that's it. My last question is, now before us, for the ICAC, in making use of public resources to enlist public support locally against corruption. Now, Mr. Tong, as the then commissioner, seemed to enjoy a lot of powers. And I don't hear any rules and regulations. It seems that he gave the final approval, acquisition of X number bottles of wine, and how and to which department would expenditure be charged. So, Mr. Tong, can you tell us the following? When you allocated the resources in this way, did you single-handedly make the decision, or did you get the approval of the CE and you were assisted by others in making the decisions? That is how the money or how the expenditures were allocated. But then the end result was that the outcome wasn't proportionate to the amount of money spent. Now, we're going to continue with our evidence gathering. Now, if somebody else was involved in this work and we're looking at the value for money, please tell us. In relation to the part about Mr. Zhang, I've already answered the question. I haven't got anything to add. As to the department as well as the colleagues, well, there are two points that are very important. First of all, the administration branch, that's very important because they are the experts in the financial matters as well as the administrative work, and they have had a number of assistants. They were fully aware of the practices. And then another point is about the responsible department. Say, for example, the community relations department. There was more than one person in the department for larger activities. It's a way of bottom up, and then everything was recorded. There were files, and then they reached me, and usually we had to talk to the or talk with the directorate grade officers when we talked about the nature of the project as well as the various items. We might not be able to cover all the details. Anything that should require special attention will be discussed more. And then there will be a summary, and then of course I would be responsible. I had the ultimate responsibility. For the administration branch, yes, they had a group of officers, and then it was headed by the assistant director. What I want to emphasize is that in the course of it, members said that it seemed that the commissioner enjoyed great powers. Well, we do have some parameters in mind. I think I've used this word before. Our yardstick was whether it could be passed by the Audit Commission. If the Audit Commission found that it would be fine, then it would be okay. If it could not be endorsed by the Audit Commission, then it shouldn't be done. For the splitting of bills, no one was sensitive to this. Well, the records won't go away. It would always be there. When the auditor comes, then he will know about it. Alan, I don't want to take up too much time of the meeting. Other members may want to ask questions. I have asked such questions because I hope, and I hope Mr. Tong would understand. Well, we're thinking of the public money. The public money has been spent on the ICC and yet to no avail. And therefore, from the perspective of value for money, we want to know where the money has gone. That's the crux of our work. Now, what we have seen is that you always talk about international relations. But then for the figures presented to us, now, Mr. C.Y. Leung has been talking about liaison with the mainland. I think probably the majority of your expenditure is in that direction. Now, you focus on the mainland, you reappointed a mainland professor. Now, within your term, it was very obvious that there was this change of approach for the ICC. Just now, I gave you the opportunity to tell us how it would benefit the public in Hong Kong in relation to our fight against corruption. You didn't make yourself clear. I try to give you the opportunity as to whether this change of approach was also endorsed and approved by the CE, the then CE. I think you were saying that he didn't object to it, and you were accountable to him, and so you must be aware of it. You also talked about other departments. I think you were being superfluous in your answer. As the commissioner of the ICAC, you were the final gatekeeper, you had the ultimate responsibility. So I just want to bring out this argument. So at this moment, I think I've ended my line of questions. But then if you think that you want to supplement to your answer briefly, I'll just give you the last chance before we move on to another member. Yes, I hope I would like to supplement briefly. Not a matter of changing the approach. In year 2006-2007, in the report of the predecessor, it was already pointed out that enhancing the relationship with the mainland and enhancing the relationship with the other international partners would be important. Well, in the audit report, I think in the beginning pages, in my five-year term, three out of those five, well, in fact, Hong Kong ranked 12 in relation to our corruption perceptions index. Well, you said that everything ultimately rests with the commissioner. Yes, I agree. But then for each project, we are required to put in a lot of thinking, experience and knowledge. And therefore, for the majority, I can't say all of the work has been perceived from bottom up. And we are talking about the senior officers, chief investigators or chief officers. They proposed and then it went all the way up to the commissioner. So before it reached me, there were already some concepts as to the making of choices and fine-tuning. The ultimate responsibility lies with the commissioner. Alan, when you made such decisions, did you have a number of close advisors that you talked to them all the time? On different occasions, well, for the three heads of departments, I can almost say that we had regular get-togethers, though they were not formal meetings. We always had discussion. That's because the focus of work and the missions of the different departments are different. They were faced with different kinds of challenges. So, say for example, for corruption prevention, the CPD would like to prevent corruption. And so I will talk more to that director in relation to that. And then for CRD, well, in fact, for the UNCAC, and they have this IAACA, that's the brainchild of the UN. Yes, I think that's enough.
I need to clarify a few things before we proceed to other questions. Commissioner, Mr. Tong, before and after your assumption of office, did you have any special team of officers who assisted you and who were not doing the same for the predecessor? Did you have a team that was helping you, which was not there when your predecessor was in office? And if so, could you give an account of why you had such a team? And annually, you have a budget for manpower. How could this be tallied with your allocation of resources? Mr. Alan Leung has said that you try to put different expenditure in different accounts. So can you explain? So after you became commissioner, did you have a special team of officer to work with you? And also in relation to allocation of resources and manpower, did you do whatever you would like to have done after my assumption of office, apart from the development in the external communication and relationship? I do have a team of people to assist me. There were two senior staff officers under the administration branch. There's a strategic research group. Not all government departments have a similar group, but I know some departments do have similar groups. This strategic research group was there. That when unprecedentedly the three departments would work together, I would like to know more about their respective functions, and I hope through the group members, I would be able to gain a better understanding of the integration of these respective departmental functions and become more effective as a whole. As for the shifting of the different budget items, well, I cannot agree that this is really the case. We have many heads, sub-heads and votes, and we have to monitor how we are spending money on a monthly basis. If we need to organize more activities, for example, if we have to co-host activities with the Center of Anti-Corruption Studies, and we may want to use the reserve for such activities instead of injecting funds into that center. Chairman, you may also be aware that we are not always going to spend all the allocations from government. We were talking about the 6th, 7th, and 8th of December. The expenditures would enter into different accounts.
Departments.
Or the... They were accounted for by different departmental expenditure or charged to different departments' accounts. And also, you cannot just do whatever you want for manpower deployment. As for the strategic development group, I think that only the CE would need such a group. So where would the expenditure be charged to, and which departments should exercise which power? So is it that it depends on your personal likings and so on? We need to write a report. Well, your predecessors have built up such a reputation for Hong Kong. It's a 12. We ranked 12 in 2008, and in 2011 we ranked 14th. You seem to suggest that you have made contribution for our breakthrough, but it's not something that happened over 1 year or any particular year. You can see in the report. And Mr. Leung had asked questions about whether you spend or expand funds into the international part of your work at the expense of local work and less was done locally. So you have to explain how you deploy your manpower and how you went about budget allocation. We have to be fair in writing a report on your work. Chairman, the strategic research groups can be found in some departments. The two officers were seconded. One was from ops department. I need to get someone with experience with operations department. And also another one was from the CPD, corruption prevention, because it would be easier to follow up the work of CLD. But I thought there would be benefits in having two seconded officers to understand the work of the two departments. I think the expenditure was charged to the administration branch. And why in 2011, in respect of this event, over the few days, different expenditure items were charged to different accounts. I think we have already got an explanation. According to the rules prevailing then, it's up to the department head to approve the funds. So members, we will have to extend the meeting by 15 to 30 minutes, if members agree, so that we don't have to ask Mr. Tong to come again. Can you make it, Mr. Tong? Yes? Concerning the screen valued at $200,000, we assume that is in ICAC. Is it still there? As a matter of fact, over the years, and I think other departments too, we would get valuable gifts from others. When I left, it was in a mini museum of ICAC. Mr. Paul, maybe we should have a field audit trip. Just joking. We have asked questions covering a number of areas. My feeling is that since the ICAC is accountable to the CE and the CE is busy, so very often ICAC doesn't have to ask anyone for approval. We asked questions about duty visits, and also we want information of the approval from the CE. We got a written reply saying that the documents of CE's approval were properly or have been properly filed. Maybe the secretariat can follow up as to why we were not allowed to see those documents. And also, do you have a cap on duty visits annually for you personally and for the commission as a whole? There's no cap as far as I know. And that is, we did not set any cap on such visits. In other words, you alone would decide when to have a visit. Not me, not one person would do this. It would be decided by the management, depending on needs. Before we have the next round, the new guidelines of from Mr. Pei, when you were commissioner, whether you went for pleasure or for duty, it's up to the CE to give you approval. Well, if it was for my own pleasure, I would have to take leave, and that would require CE's approval. If it's a duty visit, again, I need to get approval from the CE. Well, usually the table will show the purpose and the people we met. Well, I'm talking about a duty which is in name, but actually it's for pressure. Did any of these occur during your term? Mr. Chair, last time you mentioned a duty visit that I went for a 5-day visit, and of the 4 days were spent on pressure. I checked some records afterwards. According to records, there were 8 functions at rather high levels, at least at the provincial judge level. There were 3 fights. So it's simply unrealistic to have a pressure tour in those 4 days. Well, I didn't want to ask questions of a particular visit. Maybe we can also refer to more examples to be fair. Please refer to paper. Gen number, please. GN10. Page 29. Yes. Twenty-third of May. Beijing and Chengdu for 8 days. Gen 10 and again. Gen 14. It's an info paper. Page 29.
Hey,
can you find it? If I am not mistaken, you went to Beijing for 3 days. In the first instance, and then on the fourth and to the seventh day, you were in Sichuan. Can you recall? To Jiuzhaigou. Well, Paul didn't want to ask, but you gave your answer like that. And can you recall? Please answer his question. I have some impression. It was referred to as the tour to Jiuzhaigou. So I was just trying to jog your memory. Before this tour, had you ever toured Jiuzhaigou? No. After that? No. So the only tour to Jiuzhaigou is this one. The only one you visited Jiuzhaigou. The only one. I didn't go to Jiuzhaigou. Did you go to Sichuan? Yes. Sorry, I'm not trying to trick you. I'm just trying to help you remember. Because if it's near Chengdu, and of course it was Luoshan. According to our records, apart from Beijing, you also visited Sichuan. Of course, you stayed at Chengdu for some time. You also went to Wenchuan, Jiuzhaigou, and Luoshan. Wenchuan, certainly, I went there. I know Jiuzhaigou is not at Chengdu. But I remember that we could went to Wenchuan Su via Chengdu. What about Luoshan? Well, there were photos taken and I've seen them.
我想理解一下，因为你曾经都讲过咧，就话你
You once said that firstly you didn't pay attention to the itineraries, and it was arranged by the host. It would be impolite to refuse. You can just fake that you are sick and insisted that you should go back to the hotel. That's what you said last time. Yes. Concerning these duty visits during your term, on more than one occasion, it will last for than a week, and you work for 1 or 2 days during the tour. Only 1 or 2 days will be spent on ICAC duties. I don't agree. All right, so what did you do during those other days? Please tell us what you did as your duties. I think on in one or two the phases of the record, there will be a record of the people I met. Sorry, member, after my retirement, I have no access to documents. And if ICAC issue a paper telling people that this particular person met some other people, then I would know. So apart from meeting the government or head of government or government officials, we also went to the inspect the project, and that is a road project which suffers severe damage. We traveled in a vehicle for a long time to have a site visit and also to meet people responsible for construction and supervision of construction. We also went to some villages. Villages with new developments. They were in the rural area, and they also told us how they could redevelop the homes at a low cost of $100,000 or so. How much time was actually spent on touring the disaster-stricken area? Without records, I really cannot tell. But we went to more than one location. And also, there was a need to arrange the transportation. You were categorically in denial when it comes to visiting the Jiuzhaikou. What about other attractions or locations? What about the other members in your delegation? Well, from my recollection, they didn't go. There were 1 + 8 members, not just the 2 department heads or directorate officers. There were other people. But if we have the opportunity, we might want to put the same questions to other members of the delegation.
From the 11th to 17th of in 2009, the I think if you go to page 28, Beijing, Kunming, and Lijiang tour, page 28. Mr. Tong, can you find it, Paul? Again, you've met with certain persons, and did you also visit the tourist destination of Lijiang? Yes, I have the impression. It's paper 28, page 28. What is your recollection? You say you have a recollection. Well, I went to Beijing, and then Hin-ming and Lijiang. To go to Lijiang, we had to take a plane from Hin-ming. I have a very vivid recollection of that trip because I would have difficulties going to a place where there is the air is has small oxygen content. Originally, my colleagues told me not to worry, but when I went to Lijiang, I didn't feel very well. So, from the tourism perspective, I suddenly consider that to be a very, very difficult or unpleasant experience. Well, your purpose was, I wonder if it was a purpose to simply travel. No, it was arranged by the host. So you went there on official purpose. Yes, I still remember Lijiang, yes. At Lijiang, we went to Lijiang. Yeah, this I remember well, because I don't know whether or not that evening we arrived. I think it's all in your paper, Gen 14. Right. You didn't go there as a tourist. Well, there's some things which are not mentioned here. I remember, for example, that they said, well, it's in Gen 14, Paul, if you refer to it. Please go on, Paul. We're not trying to, you know, make things difficult for you. We just want to find out whether or not public funds are spent properly, because you are talking about a large delegation on a visit lasting for so many days. And also during your term, you went to the UK for three consecutive years. I've been to the UK three times, not consecutively, but within the course of 5 years. At that time, did you have a son studying in the UK at the time, during those 3 years? No. Regarding the allegation that you visited your son in the pretext of going on an official function, how would you respond to that? I have not done that. My son was not studying in the UK. I have not seen my son on those three occasions I visited the UK. I remembered it at least on one or two occasions. I had to, transit at the UK. And we also had a very tight itinerary. So again, you are categorically saying that this allegation is unfounded, and that on three occasions you've never seen your son. That would not have been possible. Right. Had there been any such overseas visits which were attended by people other than ICAC staff? Perhaps, for example, I don't know whether or not this is an improper way of putting it. For example, did Miss Helen Chan went on those overseas visits with you? I had. Before the beginning of the official visit, I went along with a friend, and it was only one friend, and I also took 2 days leave. I understand that according to government regulations, if I apply, one could bring along the spouse, but that was not the case. So you said there only had been one such occasion. No, it was a holiday. It was after I've taken my leave, let's say my visit lasted for 2 or 3 days, I can take 1 day off before or after the visit. How frequently did this happen? There have been many times. Not many times, but there have been such occasions, but not for many times. Other than Mr. Helen Chan, what about Mr. Wong Chop? You? No. What about before and after the official visit? No. I understand there have been reports that I was very familiar or with Mr. Wong. No. For official visits overseas, according to recollection, I have not went along with Mr. Wong Chop Yew. So thank you for those clear answers. But you must remember that you are testifying under oath, so thank you very much for answering many of our questions. In your official entertainment, did you ever did those persons that I mentioned attend those functions? Yes, I remember. Yes, there have been. You are referring to those two persons whom you named. Well, and they were attending the functions. They attended were official functions, official entertainment. Yes, I dare not be 100% positive. The two persons that you mentioned, well, I assume that they had attended those functions. Had there been many such occasions? Not many, according to my recollection. But yes, they had. What was it? Was it once, 5 times, or 10 times? If you are referring to those two persons, well, Chairman, I still have to answer the question. I think Mr. Wong Chop, I don't know whether or not Mr. Wong Chop Yew, you know, attended those functions once. I dare not say. If we include the large functions, for example, I remember on one occasion or two occasions, he attended a premiere for a movie, but not many times. Same for Ms. Chen. And he would also, I dare not say whether or not it had been 5 times. For Ms. Chen, it was between 5 to 10 times. Well, I don't know. According to recollection, there have not been that many times. Well, because there were other occasions I attended with her and other persons, but suddenly, using public funds. On those occasions, did you discuss matters related to the ICAC? There have been opportunities that we would discuss such businesses. Well, thank you for being so frank with your answer. Well, I think all of us would like to know why you brought along people who are not ICAC officers to attend official functions funded by public funds when ICAC matters were raised. You refer to Mr. Wong Chop Pew. I have a vivid memory because the media also covered Mr. Wong quite a lot a few years ago. Mr. Wong has certain views about and also about movie the making, and he was able to give us some suggestions. Yes. Could you go back to the fourth and fifth point, because this was asked earlier this morning. At the beginning, I think we did refer to the guidelines regarding official entertainment. Would you like to be reminded of that again? Could the chairman please remind me? Is Gen 3 46? Gentry, page 46. Paul, would you, now put your question from this perspective. On page 46 of Gentry, and I'm referring to the English version, commission standing orders regarding entertainment expenses. I think you've already looked at paragraph 4 and 5 earlier this morning. So the question is this. Under such circumstances, had you ever, pay up for the expenses because involving those persons who took along to those official functions who were not ICC officers. Mr. Tong, you are testifying under oath. That's why I asked Mr. Chair to refer you back to the question raised earlier this morning. I had. You had, yes, I had. You had what? Did you actually, refund the ICC? Yeah, I had brought along persons who were not related to the official function. And there were expenses incurred, which I pay for. It's not a question of you're paying for the expenses, but if in an official function which were paid for out of the public funds, had there been persons who are not ICC officers who attended and subsequently you have to pay for the expenses incurred in relation to those guests, or did you try to, according to my recollection, I did not actually make up for the expenses later, I actually pay for the amount involved at the spot. Did you do the same each and every time? Well, according to my recollection, there was only one occasion, none other. Now, I can't remember of any, according to my recollection. Other than Mr. Wong Chow Pew talking about movie makings and promotion or publicity, had there been other occasions when there was an official function discussing ICAC or confidential matters when non-ICAC officers were present? It wouldn't. I think confidential issues would not be discussed in front of outsiders. According to the ICAC guidelines, and also we realize that this is a very serious matter. For example, we talked about movie making earlier. I think that was, we did discuss about how we could work together to make a movie. Well, regarding the overseas visits, I understand that there were 33 such visits and you actually forgot to, declare one and you make up for it later. For on 23 occasions, you were accompanied by the director of the CRD. Is that correct? Chairman, I have not actually, taken account, but my recollection is that the director of the CRD had on many occasions went on overseas visits with me, but I can't remember the exact number. According to my understanding, CRD is the Community Relations Department. It's not in charge of international relations. What was the purpose of their accompanying you on such overseas visits? Did they function as a PR person or took care of your itinerary? Under the CRD, we have a mainland liaison group or team, and this team over the years have been responsible for the liaison work with the mainland for the commission and for the commissioner. The director of the CRD, I think that there have been three directors of the CRD during my term. For some of the time, the incumbent director of the CRD. Well, we did not require such a senior person to take care of the itinerary, but she was a very capable person, and also the talks that she gave were very successful, both overseas and also in the mainland. I still remember that she had been given many invitations to give overseas visits. I think you are digressing a little bit here. Since these occasions which you as the commissioner attended, and you also assisted by the CRD staff, why is it that by your staff, why out of the 33 overseas visits, there were 23 during which you require the company of the director of CRD? It's not every time that both of us spoke on those occasions, but there have been many times, especially when we talk about large functions that she would give a talk. Well, for these major, large-scale overseas visits, did you ask people from the mainland liaison team or any ICAC staff to actually, make some prior arrangements before you actually go on a visit? Yes, but there have not been that many such occasions. So for your overseas visit, they did involve a lot of manpower resources. If I may give one example, there was a trip to Taiwan, because we've never been to Taiwan before, so we have to make some prior arrangements beforehand in terms of protocol. I still remember that the view of the government headquarters was that we need to be careful about the itinerary. Other than that, I don't think there were other overseas visits when our staff had to go beforehand to make the prior arrangements. For many of the other visits, I would simply look at the itinerary. Chairman, I spent quite some time already, so I'll now ask Mr. Tong the last question. I think what's on my mind is that whether you like it or not, you have tried to advocate some reforms. You set up a center. You've also set up a central coordination system for recruitment. In terms of resources, you've spent quite a lot of resources on so-called internal diplomacy, mainly liaising with the mainland. And as a result, the figures show that the work that you do in Hong Kong locally that deteriorated. And that's why we kept asking you whether or not those overseas visits and official entertainments were necessary. So in your mind, you deploy so much manpower and other resources on, liaising with the mainland and making prior arrangements before you go on such visits. Did that really affect the work of the IC locally?
I don't think so. Well, for the preparatory trip, there was only one, and that's for Taiwan. I want to take this opportunity to say something about the 33 visits, like the mode as well as the distribution. Well, I quickly took a look of the 30 plus visits before I came. This is my view. Well, we mainly dealt with two systems. First, the Ministry of Supervision as well as the Procuratorate. They accounted for half of the trips, the two of them, as well as their subordinate departments and associated departments. Mr. Chairman, I want to say this. For the Supreme People's Procuratorate, it is different from the Ministry of Supervision. Well, generally speaking, if you go to the Procuratorate, they are our counterpart. So there are two counterpart departments for the ICC, and that has increased the number of visits. One other point is also important. I went to a Shanghai meeting. It was held on the mainland, but then it was hosted by the IAACA, the Procurator General was the president of the IACA, so I went for the sake of the IAACA rather than for the Procurator General. So for the number of visits involved, well, since we have got two counterpart departments, for other bureaus or departments, usually they have only got one main counterpart. And then sometimes I went to Macau. I went to Macau three times. I went to Macau and the mainland on some occasions for the sake of the IACA, and it accounted quite a substantial part. Well, believe the IACA or other mainland counterparts, for your liaison with them, well, ultimately, that is not what is being defined as the focus of your work within the ICAC ordinance. Let me say my opinion. Please answer the question. I've acceded to a lot of your requests, but I can't be giving you the permission all the time. When you answer members' questions, you need to give clear answers. Don't make special requests for this and that. We have one country, two systems. We have our own system, and the mainland has their own system. So it's a matter of non-interference from either side. And moreover, for Hong Kong and mainland China, I want to know how many cases during your term involve your participation, so that you participation. And so please answer this question. Please answer Mr. Chair's question. I don't want to give you too much time, Paul. Sorry, I think he hasn't answered. Well, I don't agree that this wasn't the focus of the ICAC's work. Next, Kenneth. Thank you. Mr. Tong, you are a member of the CPPCC. Do you know how many provinces there are in mainland China, roughly? You can choose not to answer. It is not relevant. I choose not to answer this question. There are 23 provinces and 5 autonomous regions. You said that you had to liaise with different departments and bureaus to carry out work that you thought was desirable. I think you went to Beijing, Suzhou, Nanning, Guilin, Lijiang, Hangzhou, and other tourist spots. We went to Chengdu, Harbin, and Changsha. Well, if I put it to you that if every province and municipal city is to invite you to go to give a talk, would you be going to every of them? You said that Beijing is important because you went to visit the Supreme People's Procuratorate as well as the IAACA. But I think usually you went to Beijing together with one other city. Why was it so? Was it selective? There were so many cities, so many provinces in China. Even if you spend the entire year on overseas, on visits outside of Hong Kong, you couldn't have covered them all. So for the 33 visits, I want to know whether you gave any thinking as to select which cities you should go and which you shouldn't. Yes, I did. In what way? Well, important conferences required my attendance as the commissioner. On the one hand, I had to check the purpose of the conference as to how it could have promoted the work of the department. I always attach a lot of importance to the following. That is the persons that would be meeting with me. It's not a matter of trying to curry any favors or to be networking with the powerful. The important point was how it could have promoted our work. You went to Suzhou, Hangzhou, Guilin, Nanning. You went to the scenic spots. I want to know how it had any direct relationship with the prevention work in Hong Kong and anti-corruption work in Hong Kong. You also went to Changsha. You said that you went to important conferences. What was your criteria? Now, I can understand Beijing and Shanghai because Shanghai is the commercial center and Beijing is the political center. But what about other places in the mainland? Sometimes you went for 7 or even 8 days. So what was in your mind as to why you chose to went to such cities? We weren't interfering with your personal preferences, but then you were spending public money, and so the PAC is justified to find out about the truth. So please answer the questions. Yes, I went to such cities, such places, not out of personal preference. Mr. Chairman, members, I want to point out one point. It is almost like a standard arrangement. I went to Beijing. There are two counterparts, the Supreme People's Procuratorate, as well as the Ministry of Supervision. Other than going to Beijing, we also went to another place to understand their conditions. Other than understanding the central policies, well, in fact, we would like to know how the policies were implemented. And therefore, after visiting Beijing, we would be visiting another place. And in fact, the destination was arranged by our host organization. The member referred to Chengdu, among other places like Guilin. Well, in fact, the same reason is true. I have had enough of it, Mr. Chairman. Yes, Mr. Leung. Mr. Chairman, I want to know from Mr. Tong, did you ever say no, or you were too afraid to say no, and so you were at their disposal? They could have asked you to go to Tibet or Tianshan. I want to know whether you were in control of your brain or others were in control of your brain. So did you have independent thinking? Yes, I had. So every time, was it you who decided on the destination and on the locations? If you had, did you actually take part or not? I think earlier on when you gave an answer, you said you didn't play any role, any part. Not to a great extent, as far as my participation was concerned. This is how I understood it, and this was what colleagues told me as an explanation. For the host organizations, as to who they sent to us and who received us, it was a matter for themselves. As to which places had something to show their visitors, what are the things? Scenic spots? Well, you referred to Lijiang. When I went there, then I found that at Lijiang, they showed me an investigation facility or interrogation facility. So they said that it was modeled on the ICC. So treating someone to coffee. Mr. Chairman, I don't want to dwell further on the visits. I want to switch to something else. Just now, Mr. Porcher asked many questions, and I've got the answers that I had asked. I'm interested in. Now, entertainment, official entertainment, is very interesting. Just the day before, we had a pile of papers not disclosed before. It's all on official entertainment. Even if it is related to the CRD, I think you can charge it in three different places. First of all, charge it to the CRD for official entertainment. Second, publicity. And thirdly, it could be under the official entertainment common services. So for this new information, it is under official entertainment bracket common services. So, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Tong, please take a look of Gen 14, pages 25 to 27. Pages 25 to 27. Kenneth, can you ask the Director of Audit to assist? Yes, Director of Audit, could you explain this matter? They were trying for one single sum of money on entertainment. We had to go to three different places. It's quite a difficult task. Well, for a single activity, well, the ICC has got an integrated file for the purpose of control. In the file, and how the expenditure is charged. It depends on the nature of the item. If it is more related to publicity, it will be charged to publicity vote. If it is more about entertainment, it is charged to the entertainment vote. I think this is their usual practice. As to whether it is necessary to change it, I think it is really for their management to consider the case. Thank you. Thank you, Director. Director Audit, could you also address this point from the perspective of good governance? And in fact, you have also prepared many reports of such a nature. They are excellent reports. Can you not sort of adopt this perspective to look at the issue? We studied the matter, we read the papers, we read the report, and you did the same. I want to know whether you had already considered such matters, but you didn't include them in the report, and so we had to drag on for so long. I want to know whether you have checked whether they have exceeded the budget, and has the money been transferred from one part to another, and whether the personnel was also transferred from one to another. It's a matter of good governance. I think they couldn't answer this question, so can you answer this question? We want to know about the facts. Now, you have read all the documents. You don't need to answer the question on the spot, but before we complete our report, can you help us? So it's a matter of management. We are interested in how resources and manpower are deployed. Yes, certainly. At the same time, I just want to add that, Mr. Chairman, for this audit, as I have said right from the outset, is targeted at the preventive education of the CRD rather than the entire ICAC. In relation to their compliance with the financial management practices, how expenditures are charged to different votes. Yes, I understand, but then it is of a very narrow scope. You address the matter from the perspective of value for money. A lot of issues have propped up. We can't just turn a blind eye to them, because after all, this is public money. So, when we write our report, this aspect would be important. Kenneth, I'm sorry, I would like to bring out this point. Thank you. They are all very pertinent questions. Well, regarding entertainment, three simple questions. I hope you answer in a brief way. Item 28, 55, 56. I think you went to posh clubs like the Hong Kong Jockey Club, Football Club, the Country Club, etc. I want to know about the membership. Do you have corporate membership, or is it a personal membership of your colleagues, your staff members? I believe it's the it's a case of personal membership on the part of staff members. Item 40. Grand Hyatt. Which one? Gen 14, page 27. Well, it has been rumored in the media for a long time. 9 ICC staff members and 19 guests, $35,700. you went to Grand Hyatt. Why of such an upper end? Why did you go to such a high class restaurant? Grand Hyatt. I'm not sure as to who attended. I don't know whether I can remember correctly. It was a senior official from the mainland who probably we went to Grand Hyatt twice. I'm not too sure because I can only read from the record who. Can I have a look of the list? It could have been the Procurator General. You mean Cao Jianming, Mr. Chairman? Maybe we can ask the ICC if they have a list of the attendees. Yes, we can ask for that. Two other items which are rather odd. Item 46. The 13th of April 2011, not too much money, $2,000, three ICAC officers and five guests. You went to Hong Kong Country Club, it's a Wednesday. And then item 51, you went to Tai O, Lin Hung Restaurant, six ICAC staff members, nine guests, and three bottles of wine on Friday. So, did you return to work after drinking for 51? So it was a lunch and going to work. Now, if you say that you took leave after the lunch and after drinking, this is understandable. Why would you take all the trouble to go to Tai O? Were you treating a special guest? Mr. Tong, Tai O Lin Hung Restaurant. Mr. Chairman, really, I can only speak from my memory. I may not know the details of this activity. This is because the activities listed here do not necessarily mean that I personally took part. Well, the location and the fact that it was a lunch. Well, unless they had other work. Of course, they had to return to office to work after lunch. What was the traveling time between Taiwo and your office? It would take over an hour's time to take transport back. Others? Mr. Wong? I think we need to finish by 1:30. I think Paul would like to ask questions after me. I would like to give 5 minutes to Mr. Tong to wrap up. That would be fair to him, so you may ask questions. If you can extend by 5 minutes, then you can have 10 minutes to ask questions. Well, for questions already asked by other members, I'm not going to repeat them. So basically, we know the picture. Well, from the evidence, we can see the relationship with the mainland. I think the chair has already pointed out, I think within his term of office, there was a lot of contact and there were many trips and official work. I just want to have a brief analysis and I put it to Mr. Tong and he can say yes or no or he can comment on it.
Regarding CCPCC and the fact that a retired commissioner becomes a member of the CCPPC. And also, we are now vetting your accounts and making a value for money assessment. There may be an indirect relationship between the two. The Zhao's cannot really be eliminated. Why do you want to become a member of the CPPCC? Well, we had a retired director of bureau who took part in the election to become an MPC deputy. But this one is a political consultative body under the Chinese Communist Party. No election is required. Do you know their motto? They would work side by side and they would have to be go through the. Have you heard about this the motto? Well, you can choose to answer or not in the context of this report. It's a comment from Mr. Wong. It's up to you whether you want to answer this question. Well, I haven't heard about this. Well, there are other members who know a lot about mainland organizations. This is Chinese People's Political Consultative Conference. It's under the leadership of the CCP. It involves a multiple party system. And that is the CCP would have to monitor other parties, and those parties will monitor CCP. They are in it altogether, whether it's a glory or failure. It's a history lesson. No, it's not history. It's what we have now is an existing system. All right, it's up to you, Mr. Tong, whether you want to answer it. Well, he said why he accepted the appointment, because he would be able to do something to promote the development of the financial sector or our economy. It's very, very far away from what we are discussing in terms of value for money audit. And we are here to gather evidence. Well, I allow your question. But there's a difference between the time he was a commissioner and he became a member of PPCC. Well, the members are recruited by the United Front Department. And the previous term members would identify successors, and they would nominate candidates to the United Front Department. Well, I think I've ruled that he can choose to answer or not, but I have already said that this is not related to our audit report. So you want to answer this question? Well, please just say whether you will answer the question or not. I'll answer it. Up to December last year, I have never thought of becoming a member of CPPCC. Mr. Wong talks a lot about CPPCC. He's a knowledgeable man, but I didn't know that. Okay. Anything else from Mr. Wong? Nothing. All right, I now give you, Mr. Tong, 5 minutes to wrap up, to say what you want to say. But whatever you say, it may find its way into our report. We have a report to write. I just want to give you a chance to reiterate whatever you want to say. Thank you, Chairman. Through you, Chairman, I would like to thank members. I come here under some pressure, but the whole process is meaningful. It affords opportunities
for members to answer questions, and I have been trying to answer to the best of my ability. So the first point I want to say in my summing up is that the so-called external work of ICAC was something with a clear direction set before my term, and I believed I followed the same direction, and to the best of my ability, I try to do a good job. I have to stress that in relation to the UN Convention Against Corruption, that's a very meaningful initiative in the international arena. And also in the whole local context, it would give us a good opportunity to enhance our reputation, which has always been good, and also it would also afford an opportunity to enhance Hong Kong's image. And that's also something that the Operations Review Committee agreed. Through this, we would be able to work with many international organizations. There was an international liaison, and that was the main thrust of the IACA. Coincidentally, the Procurator General was the chairman of IACA. In the past few years, both the ICAC and I myself wanted to bring some benefits through our work to Hong Kong. And of course, it was not meant to take the place of the normal duties of the CRD, but through enhancing Hong Kong's status, it was hoped that it would be good for Hong Kong's image, and through co-production of films, we will be able to air our productions through CCTV on the mainland. And so the effect could be enhanced. I was not responsible for investigation, but I certainly thought I should strengthen the cross-boundary collaboration in 2011. There was a significant enhancement. And also through cooperation with SMEs, I tried to work with other organizations to deploy resources on the mainland, especially the enhancement of corruption-free and combat against corruption in places near Hong Kong. That was what I believe we could achieve. Some members raised queries as regards whether I did something to cultivate my own benefits. Certainly that was not the case. I just wanted the Commission to be even more influential and would be able to do a better job. As for Mr. Raymond Wong's question about CPPCC, well, I would say, I want to repeat that up to December last year, that thought of becoming a member never occurred to me. I once again want to thank Chairman for giving me this opportunity to say something that I believe to be important. And I also thank the members for spending so much time on this particular part of the hearing. That would be a meaningful work. Thank you for talking about mainland liaison. A report, chapter 7 of the report is about prevention of corruption through education in Hong Kong. And you didn't explain in your last 5 minutes of speech on how you did that in Hong Kong. That's a pity. Also, I would like to inform you that although today's hearing is now drawing to a close, if necessary, we may have to invite you to come back again. Thank you. Meeting's now adjourned. The next hearing will be held on the 4th of June, whether it's in the morning or in the afternoon. We'll have a discussion at the House Committee.